And Carl was right. Ancient Egypt is evil. So, got a treat for you folks, because when I did my list of characters from Classic Who I think should in some way or another be brought into modern era, I mentioned Sutekh from the classic Doctor Who episode Pyramids of Mars, which is an episode I haven't talked about, and I actually mentioned in that video that I probably wasn't going to for a long time, since the focus on my Classic Who reviews has been stuff that I haven't already seen, and I'd seen that one before. Well, one of my patrons decided he didn't want to wait, and for his Patreon-sponsored review this month, you're getting Pyramids of Mars, which means, yes, you are in fact getting two Classic Who reviews in a month. Hey, it's what he wanted, and I'm happy to oblige. So, Pyramids of Mars. This is one that I will fully admit, very curious to revisit. And even though I wasn't planning to do it for a while, it was something I did want to do, because it's one of those episodes that shows up on a lot of people's top 10 Classic Who episodes of all time lists. You know, things like this, Genesis of the Daleks. Those tend to show up and show up very high. But when I watched it previously, I kind of was very underwhelmed by it. Now, there's a possibility that there was an overhype issue. That's the first thing. The other thing is, I also watched it because it was supposed to be so good. I watched it fairly early into my starting to take in Classic Who, and it's distinctly possible that I just wasn't quite on the right wavelength yet. And in the years since, I might have, you know, just sort of tuned into what Classic Who is like better. I might appreciate it more. At least that was my hope going in. So understand that I was coming into this kind of cautiously, and I came out of it kind of mixed. So my memory, at least to my way of thinking, pretty much held true. The things that are good, great even, are the Doctor himself and the villain, Sutekh. A lot of the other stuff going on here and the execution of it is not great. So there's a couple of things that go on. And you know what? I'm actually going to start with my issue so that I can end positive. So if it's going to bug the heck out of you that I'm about to pick apart what is considered to be one of the better classic episodes, I'm sorry. Stick around. I'll get to being nice about it. But I remember first time I watched it, seeing the mummies lumbering around and going, really? Really? And now it helps a little bit that, spoilers. There are going to be some in regards to this. I'll keep them to a minimal as I try to do with Classic Who, but they're going to be here a bit. But eventually we do get the reveal that the mummies aren't really mummies. They're robots wrapped in bandages. And that helps a little, because that's what they looked like. I mean, these huge friggin' barrel-chested things just... And, I mean, first of all, I would have preferred if they looked more like mummies. I accept that the BBC would have had neither the budget nor probably have gotten the go-ahead to do something really... Basically, to do something like they did on Mummy on the Orient Express, you know, in Modern Who. Something like that I would have loved. You could still say that it's a robot just wrapped in bandages and made to look like a mummy. But even accepting that they couldn't do that, how big and bulky and uniform looking these things were, and also the way that they're shot, because I found myself thinking about, say, the scarecrows in the Family of Blood Human Nature two-parter, and they're pretty generic and they just kind of lumber around, but it's the way in which they're shot, largely because when those things appear, it's usually at the very least dusk, if not nighttime, and here we've got broad daylight, these long lingering shots of these things just through the woods at this really slow pace, and we're supposed to believe they also catch up to people. It's like, oh my god, really? So that's but now admittedly that's fairly superficial, and that is partly a production values thing, but I do think it's also a design thing. I do think even with the production values of what they could have pulled off with of the time, they could have done better than that. Then there's issues of pacing, and this is something that I run into with Classic Who on a semi-regular basis. Now, I've actually praised the pacing of Classic Who in some earlier videos, insofar as when the slower pacing of these stories versus modern stories is done correctly, that means we get a better chance to understand the world this story is taking place in, the supporting cast that we're dealing with, and they feel less like fodder, and it feels less like a one-off sort of place that the Doctor just stops in and we never hear or see from again, we don't care. However, when done incorrectly, what we end up with is a bunch of extended sequences that are just filler and there to pad out the runtime and are boring. So boring. And there's two major examples in this, and they're mostly in the front end of this four-parter. There's this really extended sequence of the Doctor, or maybe it's even just Sarah Jane, but I remember Sarah Jane, you know, hiding from the mummies. And, like, it goes on for minutes. Like, she runs and she hides and they follow and she hides. And there's this entire thing with this poacher who's on the grounds where these things are. And there's, we keep coming back to the mummies hunting him down and eventually killing him. And that has zero plot relevance to anything going on. I mean, the poacher mattered insofar as he had a shed that had stuff that they needed to raid for what they're trying to do, you know, to stop the villain. But so he needed, it didn't hurt for him to be established, but for him to get like an extended, like spread out over a couple of the parts of this story thing where he keeps showing up and he's running and he's hiding and he's, and then just dies. Like, as a character, aside from the fact that he had a shed with stuff they needed, he serves no purpose and eats up a stupid amount of screen time. And this isn't a case where we're fleshing out and getting to know, you know, the supporting cast better, because he doesn't do anything. He's not really much of a character. He's not characterized in any meaningful way. It's just filler. And that's one of the things that can drive me nuts sometimes. It's pretty rare that you see it in a four-part story. I've complained about filler before, but I've done it on things that are like six parts plus. So to get filler, what feels like filler like that in a four-part story is just frustrating to me in a lot of ways. And it's one of the things that, that can drive me nuts about Classic Who. I wish that Classic Who better recognized its limitations, not just in terms of production value, but in terms of how exciting a quote-unquote chase could be made with the time and the budget and the means that they had. Frankly, most of the time it couldn't be made to be very exciting, so I wish they wouldn't do it so dang much. So it's that kind of stuff that hampers a lot of my enjoyment of this. It's that kind of annoying padding. It's some of those choices in terms of the ways in which they try and realize these ideas. Having said all that, the Doctor and Sutek are both great in this. Now, the Doctor himself, I do want to single out Tom Baker's performance here, because I'm not going to say it's different than any other performance he does, but it is a distinctly different flavor from what we usually get from him, because usually Tom Baker, who is my favorite Doctor, has a bit more of a sense of fun. He's deadly serious in this one. Like, he's barely cracking jokes. He's scolding Sarah Jane and other people around him, not just like, well, that was foolish, but like harshly. And honestly, it's his performance that sells how dangerous Sutek is. Because as far as the kinds of actions they're engaging with, you know, trying to stop all these minions that are wandering around and putting, you know, trying to disassemble and then put together their own version of some technobabble, whatever, that's all basic Doctor Who stuff. The number of stories in which he does those things are innumerable. But the way in which you have him doing what are still very basic Doctor Who things, but you believe that the stakes are higher, even though what he's going through is very typical, is by having him sell how much more dangerous it is this time. And he does that. He does that really well. I think the sense of weight and danger of this entire story, a lot of that is owed just to his performance. He's really good in this. And it helped that his seriousness is carried through, because he was, I would say, excessively and annoyingly dismissive of Sarah Jane, but I can kind of hand wave it in this specific case because of the circumstances and how focused he was going to be, and he just didn't have time to slow down for her. And that's not to say Sarah Jane is dumb, but for any companion to keep up with him, he has to slow down. And he didn't have the time or the patience. So I'm kind of okay with that, even though in general, I don't like when particularly this doctor gets overly dismissive of Sarah Jane. But, you know, in this case, it kind of works. Now, Sutek, great voice. I'd heard, I should have double checked this. I'm pretty sure it's true. I checked it once. I'm pretty sure it's true. Same guy who came back and did the voice for the Beast in The Impossible Planet and the Satan Pit two-parter in Series 2. So not only is it a deep, resonating, strong voice, beyond that, he has a lot of nuances to prefer. It's the antithesis of the endless bellowing that we got from Omega in Arc of Infinity. And it's having those quieter moments. It's having that arrogance. It's having that sense of triumph. It's having that sense of desperation even later. You know, as things start to come apart in frustration, he feels like a fully formed character, despite the fact that he doesn't do very much. I mean, like, physically, he's just locked in place. He can't move for the vast majority of his story. Yet he feels like a fully formed character just because of the depth and the nuance and the layers that are in the vocal performance. And the whole concept behind Sutek is also pretty cool. As far as, you know, the if you're gonna do, and I say this as if it's cliche now, I'm not sure how cliche it was in the 70s when this was done, but as cliche as it is now to have, like, you know, aliens wrapped up with Egypt stuff, this is still a pretty cool take and a pretty cool sell on it. You know, the whole idea that the gods were real, but they weren't gods. They were incredibly powerful aliens, and he was the worst of them. The way in which he is defeated is clever. It's ever so slightly timey-wimey. Not to the level that, like, say, Moffat would tend to do, but for classic era, yeah, it uses the elements of the more science-y, you know, bendy, time-travel-y kind of stuff that plays into the solution a little bit more than was typical for the era, which I liked and I appreciated. You know, I bagged on the production values in terms of the mummies. There is some good production value here. There are some impressive, like, explosions in this. Very obviously of models, but there's still, for this show, that's some decent explosions, so props to it. So this is a good story, and what makes it good is Tom Baker and Sutek. And the two of them are good enough to make this worth, but a lot of the other stuff going on around it, I think, holds it back and would keep it from probably making my own top 10 list of classic era episodes, which, no, don't ask me when I'm gonna get around to that, because I have no idea. I've still got a lot of classic stuff to catch up on. But it is still worth seeing, because it is quite good. I still feel it tends to be overhyped, considering how many times I see people be like, it's the greatest story ever! I'm like, really? Because the parts that weren't great kind of stick out of my mind. When was the last time you rewatched it? That's sort of like what I think to myself, but I don't, like, mean that rewatch it, you won't think it's as good. I mean, maybe you would. There's stuff that I have always loved, I rewatch, and I still don't see the flaws in it. So, you know, whatever. If you love it, that's great. And if you haven't seen it and you like classic Doctor Who, you should watch it, because it is good. So there you go. Pyramids of Mars, classic Who. What are your thoughts on it? Whatever they are, drop something down in the comments. Let's talk about it. There's all the stuff to do. Support me on Patreon. Follow me on Twitter. Podcast. Blah, 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 blah. And the links are down in the description. So until next time, this council is adjourned.